Okay, I admit it. We've titled this segment Success Redefined, and frankly, it was probably pretty obvious. The 04 F-150 is going to break new ground. Now, I would love to spend time on the history of the F-Series with you, but frankly, we just don't have time. This truck is all new, all new. And to that end, I've got a lot to share with you. This truck war thing is about to get hot. I want you to have the information. Frankly, in this game, it starts with styling, and this is not as easy as you might first think. You've got to sell a message. Listen, from Ford, what is it? Built Ford truck tough, man. This is a tough truck. Well, to that end, how do you do that and not make yourself look like a park bench? You want to show that you're refined, that you're sophisticated, that you got technology, that you got comfort and luxury and handling. Whoa, this isn't so easy all of a sudden. How do you convey the family lineage in terms of the appearance of the vehicle so people automatically tie it together? At the same time, tell your story by just its looks and still express confidence that the buyer made the right choice. This is how you do it. And every magazine out there, every radio show out there agrees with me across the board. Very, very strong lineup here. You can recognize it as a Ford product right off the get-go. I love that. I think people who buy the product wants it. Of course, I love the size. We're starting to brag a bit. I think this is good news in terms of our own emblem. I love the additional airflow to both not only the radiators, but the air conditioner as well. I think that proves itself valuable in terms of functionality. You've gone to the power dome hood. Now, guess what? That's because there's actually a reason to do it. You've got some power. We're going to be talking about that in a minute. But I love that this hood says, don't take me lightly, Jack. I'm coming. And to that end, the power dome does a great job. Other key issues, and I really think in a lot of ways, new ways to go, bringing the belt line up so deliberately high right here to the base of the A-pillar and into what we call the greenhouse. Now, a whole new trend reversal here. For years, we've been watching the greenhouse, the side glass, lean on in. This is referred to as tumble home. And they've been bringing it in for that sexier, smoother, sporty GT touring car look. Guess what? This is a truck. So you stepped out of the norm, you quit following the sheep, and you set the new standard. Out. You brought it out. And you ultimately gained interior headroom as a benefit. I think it enhanced the presence, but more importantly, I think from a functionality standpoint, this was a winner. Other clever stunts. You grabbed the cut line for the mirrors here in the door right off the Super Duty look. I love the fact that now this buyer gets that image in the F-150. And this, I think, is a very recognizable and totally innovative line. It, too, has a function benefit. No matter what stature driver we put in here, they've got a great line of sight to the mirror. And that's a plus. A good win situation. Okay, let's take this fairly radical thought and continue to run past the greenhouse with a very high belt line. If you had stuck with tradition, had you stuck with what everybody else had been doing, you're the leader, you can't afford to do that, you'd have come back down and met your conventional box height. Nope, you kept the belt line nice and high. You kept selling the message all the way back. You look at trucks, there's a number of different interesting nose cones, but they quit selling the message the minute they got around the side or to the back. Not the case here. You went taller, 2 inches taller in your bed rail height, all the way back. And you included standard cap rail protectors, which I think is so smart. I mean, we want to tell this customer, yeah, use this thing, go ahead. Well, why not help them protect it? And to that end, they want to throw lumber in here, they want to throw rocks in here, they want to throw lawn equipment in here. You've got double wall construction, you've got great tie downs, and a lot of flexibility in how you can stack and certainly store things here. It's all part of the message that says, I'm not only telling you to use me, I'm proving to you you can use me. And here's one. In certain capacities, you can actually put 3,000 pounds of payload in here, which, by the way, is, in fact, best in class. But more importantly, here's a notion. What if you actually put 3,000 pounds in here and it stayed on the truck? I think it's a clever idea. And to that end, some of the largest bed bolts in the market. Boy, most of your competitors don't even come close. There you got 6 of them just mounting this thing rigidly to the frame. It's not going anywhere. And then, of course, innovation where nobody was expecting it. And unfortunately, it's one of those deals when you first see it, you go, man, that seems so obvious. Well, you know what? I guess it wasn't as obvious as we'd like to think because no one else has done it. And that's called tailgate assist. A built-in torsion bar system, by the way, still removable, but a built-in torsion bar system that makes virtually one-hand operation to use a tailgate. This is the kind of stuff, this is the kind of innovation that makes you a leader. But beyond that, beyond all this presence and appearance and innovation and cleverness here, how about what it all sits on? Because it's frame that separates you from everybody else in the game. And that I'm anxious to show you. Come along. Okay, I'm going to take you where the customer rarely gets to go, at least before you sell them the vehicle. And it's kind of a shame because they're really missing something by not seeing the story behind the story. there it is. To me, it's really the, boy, it's really the core issue. This chassis, this frame is awesome. And that becomes so valuable to the customer because that's the backbone. You know, you could talk about having a Pierre Cardin suit all you want. If you put it on a slob, it's on a slob. It doesn't make that person a better person. It's the same situation here. You can design the prettiest body you think you got, but if you put it on a junk frame, and there are junk frames out there, you haven't built a truck. You just built something that looks like a truck. This is core moral money. This is where the hidden value of the product really is, because a frame does so much for you in this application. For one thing, it's referred to as a ladder-style frame. It has two main rails and cross members. If you took everything off of it, leaned up against the building, it'd look like a ladder. But how that frame gets built, now that's where you find out about the company, the core content of the company. What I mean by that is, will they spend money where the customer can't see it? Let me give you a classic example. When trucks were just work trucks and no one had any expectation of being quiet or riding nice or handling good, all that was required of the frame, quite frankly, to run through a potato field was what was referred to as a C-channel design. If you looked from in section view from the front or back or cut them in the middle, this is what you saw, a C-channel. And by the way, for example, I'm just using PVC from Rain Gutter for your house. You can get this at a local home supply store and show the customer what we're talking about. So the problem with C-channel is it's pretty strong and bend. You could put a lot of potatoes on this dude and not bend it. Ah, but when somebody said, boy, wouldn't it be nice when trucks would go around a corner or avoid an accident or actually ride nice or last longer and not squeak and rattle? Uh-oh, now we're talking about torsional load. No longer just a pressure vertically, but what about the twisting that comes in from the tires and suspension? As you can see, C-Channel hates that. There is no resistance, and things went bad. Now you got to step up and say, wait a second, we got to spend money, unfortunately, underneath the vehicle, but it's so important, the critical into the vehicle. Now, make sure here's what I'm talking about. This is what we refer to, and you've heard the term a lot lately, and a lot of people are bragging about the fact that they've gone fully boxed on the frame section. You know what? You have to anymore. And as you can see now, when you run these two big rails down it, you got two fully boxed frame rails. It's real strong and bend. Clearly, you gain bend strength, vertical load strength, but its resistance to twist is huge. Then, of course, you go the extra mile and start adding those cross members I told you about. Well, some people do. You actually add seven, an outstanding count that really strengthens it up. Ah, and you go one notch further. You actually run them through the frame rail, and you weld them on both sides. This is why this frame is now twice as strong as your previous iteration, and it was already one of the best frames in the business. Big gains, big value to the customer. Now, another term that's being bandied around by one particular car company, General Motors, they love to brag about the fact that they hydroform their frame rails, and I don't blame them. It's a real value issue. What they're talking about is, we need to bend this rail because it's got to get around the suspension, down past the back of the engine and transmission, come back and begin to run along the body and clear the rear end. So there are bends in it. Well, if you just bend this, just cold metal, around a mandrel, what they call a mandrel bent, what happens is you get the bend, looks just pretty enough, but you have crushed the molecules on the inside, grown or stretched the molecules on the outside of the radius, you've weakened the frame. Well, General Motors comes out and it starts bragging about the fact that in the front portion of its frame, it's making these bends by hydroforming. What they're talking about is filling the frame rail, filling it literally with a very water-based oil, very thin water kind of substance to it, and they put it in a form and they make the bends, they force the bends by actually clamping on it with that fluid in it. What that does is it keeps the molecules in the radius and doesn't stretch them on the outside, so you never weaken it. Great stuff, which is why you've been doing it for nearly 20 years. We just never thought to brag about it before. General Motors comes along, finally figures out that you can do this stuff, and they just start bragging about it. I don't blame them. It's a smart thing to do. I just wish the customer fully understood what they're actually getting as a direct result. Another thing is, we talk about crush zones, or another way of saying, we just don't use this verbiage, is when you talk about crush zones, where will the frame give up? Will a frame sacrifice itself in the interest of protecting the people inside the vehicle? Well, when you do these kind of controlled bends, you get to design in, our engineers actually design in, okay, this will bend at this point of force, this will start to bend at this point of force, this will continue to bend at this level of force, eating all that energy, lowering it before it gets to you. Yes, it bends the frame, but it saves the occupants. It's really neat moral money that gets hidden away underneath the vehicle. The customer never gets to see it. Another big gain for 04, and that is the fact that you've gone an inch and a half wider in track. If these were the two front tires, and they were here, we're now talking about them being out here. And you can see in a vertical environment, a lateral and vertical environment, how that would, in fact, enhance the stability of the vehicle. And it pays big benefits. But there's more. You went with, and let me use my pointer here, maybe it'll help, because it is dark in here. You've gone to a term you'll see in your RENT material of a coil over shock. Here's the coil spring, that's what the truck actually rides on, and there's the shock absorber, that's what controls this spring. By putting them together as a unit, you gain a lot of isolation of NVH, you gain some roll stability and roll influence, but mostly you gain control over the spring. That's huge. You've gone to what is referred to as the SLA, short and long arm suspension system. The benefits, the dividends have been huge for the customer. You've given yourself lots of wheel travel, which really works out well for ride control and durability. And you've gained a lot of control of how you plant that tire on the ground. This was a smart move and I think made a big change. Another key detail, you talk about going to rack and pinion steering, a very direct link. If this is a steering wheel and this is a shaft down to the steering, it's a very direct link that very instantaneously communicates whatever you wanted out here to this wheel and tire package. I love it. All purpose-built race cars, rack and pinion steering, you've got that now for 04. Big game. Back here, and kind of hidden, unfortunately, it's very dark, but if you look through your RENT source book stuff, you'll see pictures of this. There's a stabilizer bar. Now, in racing, we call them anti-roll bars, and that's really their job. Our goal with a stabilizer bar is, as you go around a corner, you're heading off to the right here, you're starting to move weight to the outside, this tire loses some of its grip. Well, by putting stabilizer bars on here, we not only control the flatness of the body, we put more of that weight back on the inside tire. It improves the traction and stability. The customer is the winner that your company spends money in places like that where they can't see it. Let's go beyond it another notch. It makes me insane. People can't wait to brag about what their truck will pull, but no one ever wants to talk about what their truck will stop. Well, I think the moral content, the moral obligation is here. You got to make sure you got enough brake to slow all the mass you're telling people to use. Well, to that end, a 13-inch diameter brake rotor up here, or disc as it's sometimes referred to, and as you can see, if you look down through it, that it's actually vented. It actually is a fully vented air coming in through the center, out through these slots and out through the wheel to help cool it down. And I realize this is getting to the minutia, but I want you to understand where the money got spent. This is a caliper, the brake caliper. This is what puts the clamping force on it, makes the brake pads squeeze on this. You've stiffened this up so you have even more clamping force. And remember, your vehicles come standard for 04 with ABS and EBD, electronic brake force distribution. This is an awesome package. It has so much moral content and has so much appropriate technology. The customer really is the winner. They see this nice, pretty 17-inch or 18-inch wheel. What they don't see is the prettier stuff that really is the basis for the vehicle. Believe it or not, there's actually more to tell in the rear. Okay, not quite as deep a dive in the back as we went in the front, but some key issues for 04 I'm anxious to share with you. First of all, this is a leaf spring. Leaf springs are really good at load variables. You want to put a trailer on, you want to put a lot of weight back there. These springs adjust very nicely to that. To make sure that this thing, which is the only link, by the way, hooking it to the frame, keeps a lot of control over the rear end, you went a half inch wider in leaf spring dimension this year. This really proved to be important. You're nearly 3 inches wide now, and it really keeps the rear wheels nice and straight under the back of the vehicle. Nobody wants to drive a 70-mile-an-hour forklift. You want these wheels aimed straight all the time. This really works out nicely. A bigger change, in all fairness, but one that may be a little harder to understand or worse explain to the customer, but one you'd have to take ownership of, is the fact you've gone to an outboard-mounted shock absorber. Traditionally, you're used to seeing these things mounted in near the rear end. Now you've moved them all the way out here on this frame. See, with a nice stiff frame, you can make decisions like this. Now, this benefit is also huge. It controls this spring, but it also gives us more control in roll, which stabilizes the vehicle and controls this spring. Where you really see the benefit of that is in transient response, where the vehicle really wants to transfer a lot of weight. Well, guess what? The shock absorber gets very involved, calms that down. This, in all honesty, is going to be a trend we're going to see across the board. One of the things I want to remind you about, if going to this nice stiff frame, case in point, Dodge really did, for 04, increase their frame stiffness, but they didn't capitalize on it, particularly in the front, by going with more suspension travel, which would have really improved their handling. You've kept a lot of travel in here. You've got a nice stiff frame to deliver that job. Again, disc brake in the rear, fully vented, reinforced caliber, good, strong, stout stuff. And I want to remind you, 17 and 18-inch wheels available. 17 is standard now. Man, does this stuff change quickly. And, of course, an 18-inch tire available is an option. Last detail, 9,900 pounds of towing capacity. 9,900 pounds. Awesome, awesome stuff. Now, to support that best-in-class tow capacity, I mean really best-in-class tow capacity, you've got to have powertrains. So to that end, you're covered. I'm a huge fan of your base engine, what I consider your value motor, and an outstanding V8, the 4.6-liter single overhead cam. A great motor, 231 horsepower, 293 pound-feet of torque. A very good entry engine. Of course, the hot news, the one that's got everyone talking, is, of course, the 5.4. Three valves per cylinder, variable twin cam timing, 300 horsepower, 365 pound-feet of torque, and all of it at the bottom part of the tachometer. That's a work truck you can live with. You got aluminum cylinder heads, you got 100,000 miles between tune-ups, and one I just flat have to admit to, you've got fail-safe cooling, which I frankly just did not understand the value of initially. But I have so come to appreciate what engineering has accomplished, the ability for this owner to get in a situation where something cuts a hose or punctures a radiator and their day is not done. Or worse, not only not done, they didn't hurt the motor, because this thing will self-protect and limp them home. Nice technology. I'm telling you, you're number one for a reason. Hey, another key reason, models. Boy, you needed a model lineup that really spoke to everybody. This truck is so aspirational. How do you get to every customer out there? You do it with model lineup. And to that end, you've got the XL, what Ford refers to as the workhorse. You got the STX, kind of the fun athletic one, really kind of the youth version of the trucks. And of course, XLT, that'll be all purpose. And a lot of your buyers will be very XLT aspirational. Of course, FX4. Listen, Helen Keller will see this truck coming down the road. This dude is not sneaking in or apologizing anywhere it goes. It's about off-roading, it's about owning the road, and boy, FX4 says it from front to back. And then, of course, the success truck, and that's going to be the Lariat. It really is the epitome, if you will, of truck luxury. To that end, more rocking news, more things to shake your world up. Guess what? Every cab configuration you got, including regular, is now four doors. Another segment exclusive. You're the first to do it. They'll all follow. But just one more time, you prove to the consumer we're out front, we know the market, and we know the game. But to really show you these interiors, let me take you inside. I fooled you, didn't I? I told you I was going to show you the interior. I guess I just failed to mention it was going to be at highway speeds. Look, there's a real agenda to this. I wanted you to see how well the package works in total. We talk about interiors, and Lord knows you've set a new standard there, but I wanted you to see how the package works in total. The stronger frame, the better suspension, the refined engines, the stronger structure, how everything ties together. Traditionally, you say something tows 9,900 pounds, you're riding down the road like this. That ain't happening here. Look at how calm, how stable, how quiet, and how balanced this all is. You know, Car and Driver tested this thing recently with a 5.4 motor in a four-wheel drive super cab going 70 miles an hour and recorded an interior DVA of 68. Man, that's right there with mid-sized luxury sedans. It's an awesome, awesome package. This thing's calm, composed, it handles, and it's so luxurious. What a great package. We told you right up front, the 04 F-150 redefined success.